right, good evening. Good to see everyone here tonight. We'll go ahead and begin by singing a little bit. There's a quaint idea. I just thought of it just now. We'd start a church service with singing. Original idea. Patented. Too bad Brother Hamblin isn't here to appreciate it. All right, number 316 now. Let's sing together. Number 316, let's stand together. I have decided to follow Jesus. All right, I have decided to follow Jesus. Here's what we're going to do now. We've got three verses. We're going to make it four. We're going to sing the first verse over again. Everyone sing together on the first verse. Everyone unison on the melody. And if you say, I didn't know there was anything else to sing, do that all four times we sing, okay? If you know what alto is, if you speak that language on the second verse, then you sing alto and you join us doing that. On the third verse, if you know what bass is, sing that with us. And the altos continue to sing. And then as we repeat, we're going to add tenors. If there's one tenor, just one. The Lord is looking for one man to stand in the gap. If there's any tenors on the last time we sing, we'll bring you guys in. All right? So everyone together. I have ready. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have tenors. If there is one, you join us. Here we go. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus.
I have decided to follow Jesus.
No turning back. No turning back. Amen. Amen. Good singing, church. Amen.
All right. Hope you had a good day today, a good spring day. It was spring, I know, because it rained out there. All right. It was a good wet day. That means spring is here. But it was nice and warm. Not going to be quite as warm tomorrow. And then tomorrow night is the last night of our spring revival. So Saturday, going to be 30 degrees with ice and snow outside because our spring revival is over, right? Now, it won't be... not going to be quite that cold, but we sure have. The Lord has been good, giving us some good weather this week, and we appreciate that. Glad you could be here tonight, make it a point to be here on a Thursday night, not normally a night that we're in church, but I enjoy being in church on nights that we're not normally in church. I like showing the Lord that I love Him, and I want to be there when it's not ordinary to be there, so we're glad you're here this evening. Let's go to the Lord together in prayer. Father, we are thankful that we can be here tonight on this Thursday, Lord, that we can sing our songs together, that we can pray together, Father, that we can be fed from the Word of God together, and we do pray again tonight that, God, you would use the Word of God and the preacher, Lord, to challenge and to speak to our hearts and to search our hearts, God, and to challenge us in the area of our Christian living, in our witness, Father, our walk with you. We just pray you would have control of the service tonight and give us, Father, exactly what we need to hear, whether we realize it or not. Father, you know what we need, and so we pray you give it to us this evening. God, we know that when your preacher preaches, he might touch on something that hits us, or, Father, he might be talking about something that you use Lord, to lead us in a different direction, but you speak one way or the other, and we're so thankful for that. And we pray that you would do that tonight for our service. Father, be with those that are not able physically to get up and be out with us. We pray you'd watch over them tonight. Lord, protect them. Bring them back soon. We ask these things tonight in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated.
Let's turn together number 158. Number 158. And as we're turning there, I believe it was Richard Wurmbrand, somebody heard him speak, and he mentioned that when they sang in the churches in his country, that they did not use instruments. And a member of the Church of Christ jumped on it. And if you know anything about the Church of Christ, they believe that we are unscriptural because we use instruments. And Richard Wurmbrand, I'm not going to say exactly what he said, but to paraphrase it, he said, they said, well, don't you, you agree with us then? Everybody's trying to get them to take sides. You agree with us. You know that using instruments in the service is unscriptural. And he said, friend, where I'm from, if we had instruments, that would signal the secret police to come. They would know where we were. He said, if we could worship in freedom, we would be as loud and use as many instruments as we possibly could. And so tonight, as you sing, we're singing without instruments. But just remember, Paul didn't have a 30-piece orchestra when he sang in the prison cell. David probably didn't even have his harp when he was singing out looking at the stars. And so we're going to sing, Oh, for a Thousand Tongues to Sing, My Great Redeemer's Praise. All right, so 158, hope you found it now. Already, oh, for a thousand tongues to sing, my great Redeemer's praise, the glories of my God and King, the triumphs of his grace. Are you thankful for your tongue? Have you talked to somebody today? Said hello to somebody you love today? Have you tasted something today? Isn't it something that God put the taste buds on that thing that you need to talk to him? And how rarely do we talk to him, but yet we'll make sure we taste something good. Are you sure you mean what you sang there? Let's sing the first verse over again. Because, you know, if you're not thankful for something, God may be just liable to take it away. And how terrible would that be, not to be able to taste bitter black coffee? Amen? I mean, not that you need a tongue for that, but anyways. All right, here we go. Let's sing verse 1 all over again. Let's just think about it here. We're being thankful for a part of our body God gave us to praise him. Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing, my great Redeemer's praise, the glories of my God and King, the triumphs of his grace. My gracious Master and my God, assist me to
someone from the Church of Christ, Church of Christ member, and we were talking, and they were talking about instruments in church, as Pastor Braden was talking about, saying how evil and wicked it is to have instruments in church. You're not supposed to have instruments. It's supposed to be just your voice. And tried to speak with them about them using in the temple symbols and all those things and all that happened, and they weren't going to be convinced. And then at the end of the conversation, they said, well, I got to leave. My wife and I are going to the Shania Twain concert tonight. Now, am I the only one that sees a real problem with that? That instruments are wicked and ungodly, but I guess only if you use them in church. If you use them out there, they're fine. So that's just that kind of thinking, I guess. Well, good news. We finally got a hold of Tom today. We found out where he is. Bad news, he's in the hospital in Zanesville. And he had emergency surgery on his foot this past Sunday. Apparently, it was in very, very bad shape, and I couldn't really understand over the phone talking with him how this happened so suddenly. But Sunday, his son noticed a lot of problems with his dad's foot and called the squad. They took him into Cambridge. They took him to Zanesville. They did surgery on Sunday. He's got it all wrapped, kind of like Charles Clark went through here a while ago. It's got it all wrapped and a pump on it to keep the infection and fluids out. So he'll be in there for a little while, and then he'll be in a nursing home for 20 days after that to go through rehabilitation. So pray for Tom. Pray he can get back on his feet. He just retired at 70 years old. He just retired on February 16th, I think, from his job, and boom, this happened to him. So pray for him that God will get him back up on his feet. Also, Brother Braden was telling me, Brother Jeff told me that Kenny Eltringham was through here today on his way to the hospital to go pick up Lorna. And so he was going to get here, and he said she lost, how many pounds, Jeff, did you? 25 pounds she's lost from laying flat on her back in the hospital all that time. So you pray for her. He said she sounded good on the phone, and her spirits are up, so you pray that she'll get home and get back on her feet, get going again. So we pray for these two as well as others. All right, we're going to take an offering tonight. Anything you give is for Dr. Hamblin, so we encourage you to give. We're doing something? Okay, great. I appreciate that, John. We got something planned for it. So we'll pray. Pastor Braden will pray, and then we'll have a song and come and bring your offering.
Heavenly Father, we are thankful, Lord, for a chance to come on a Thursday night. Lord, we anticipate. I am excited, Lord, about what you might do tonight, Lord. And Father, I know that many times what you need out of us is just to be in the right place at the right time. And if nothing good happens, Lord, it was good practice for us to be where we should be. But Lord, I pray that you would do something tonight. And Father, feed our hungry souls and recharge us, Father. And I pray that you would bless this offering for the sake of the evangelist, Lord, for the sake of this meeting. I pray that you would bless the pianist tonight and help him to play well. In Christ's name, amen. Stand together. Number 243, then we'll sing together. This song is good with a band. This song is good with an orchestra. This song is good with a piano. It's good with a guitar. It's just good. It doesn't matter how you sing it. Victory in Jesus. Number 243, we'll sing. Number 243. I heard an old story. How a Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sins and won. With his redeeming blood.
but praise God, He loved me ere I knew Him, and all my love is to Him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about a mansion He has built for me.
You may be seated. If that doesn't help you to think yourself happy, I don't know what will. Amen.
All right. Thursday night. Ready for what God has for you this evening? Prayed up and ready to listen. Take our minds off of what you did today. For Bruce, that'll be hard. He was out there hitting the golf ball for 18 holes today, so that's going to... You've got to keep him awake tonight, Brother Hamblin, all right? He got out there and did that. So whatever you did today, try to put it out of your mind. Whatever you got planned for tomorrow, put it off till tomorrow. And just get ready for whatever God's got for you tonight. That's the best way to come, anticipating and hungry for what has. Anytime you hear the preaching of the Word of God, ask God, Lord, what do you have for me tonight? Don't say, Lord... Skin those other people, those stinking backslidden Christians. Lord, get them. And I'll say, Lord, what do you have for me tonight? Because every time you come, God has something for us. It's just a matter of us getting it or not. So, Brother Hamblin, come ahead, sir.
You're welcome. Open your Bibles, the book of Isaiah, chapter 44. We're thankful for each of you that are in the service tonight. And John, God bless you, buddy. Where'd you go? He's in the bathroom. Okay. Well, would you tell him that I said, great job. And I appreciate John playing the offertory tonight. And I'm going to count the offering tonight, just from tonight. And if it's the highest of the week, then John's going to play every offertory for me from here all the way till I go to heaven or the Lord comes to take me to heaven. I'm thankful for each of you that are in the service tonight, and I appreciated our brother leading us in that song, Victory in Jesus. It reminded me years ago, I was preaching in a jubilee in Groves, Texas. Groves, Texas is just outside of Beaumont, Port Arthur, Texas, and I was there preaching in a jubilee. And they had brought in a trio to sing, and they got up just before I was to preach. They were the special music, and one of the members of the trio, and Brother Brayden, and it reminded me when you led us in a song tonight, he got up and he said, we want to sing a song that my grandfather wrote, and they sang Victory in Jesus. And it was his grandfather, E.M. Bartlett, that wrote that great hymn. And boy, you just never know what you're going to get when you go to God's house. And boy, to be able to hear that song tonight just reminded me of the great heritage, the great history that we have as a fundamentalist. You realize that the songs that we sing every single service, there's at least one in every service that was sung in a Billy Sunday meeting, that was sung in an Oliver B. Green meeting, that was sung in a John R. Rice meeting. And I mean, that's our heritage. That's our history. And I'm happy to report to you that old-time religion, in spite of what you may hear on the internet, like it, lump it, bump it, jump it, take it across the street and dump it, old-time religion is alive and well. And so thank you, Brother Brayton, for leading us in that great hymn, Victory in Jesus. You know why they're called hymns? They're all about Him. And I always rejoice when I hear the songs of Zion in the house of God. It was my hero, Billy Sunday, who said, bad church music is as worthless as a glass eye at a keyhole. Billy Sunday said that. And that's about how I feel in regards to bad church music. Book of Isaiah, chapter number 44, and I'll take but one verse of scripture for our text, and it will be verse number 8. Book of Isaiah, chapter 44, and verse number 8. And I would invite you to stand with me as I read the word of God. Isaiah, John, by the way, good job, buddy. Good job on the offertory. I appreciate it. Isaiah chapter 44 and verse number 8. Now, if you have your Bible with you, would you lift it and wave it at me if you brought your Bible with you? Oh, amen. That's a beautiful sight. Now, when you come to the house of God, you need to bring the Word of God with you. You should never take man's word for it, but always take God's word for it. And you won't make the right kind of preacher nervous, the right kind of preacher, if you bring your Bible with you to hear him preach. The wrong kind of preacher, he'll be nervous every time. But the right kind of preacher will be glad and grateful that you brought the Word of God to the house of God to hear the man of God preach. Now that Bible that you're waving around a moment ago, either on the edge or on the fly leaf, needs to read King James Version. That's what it needs to read. And if you do not have a King James Bible, then, you see me or Dr. Leithley after the service, and we'll make sure that you get a King James Bible, one of those genuine Morocco leather kind, the Cadillac of King James Bibles. We'll get you one. We'll have Brother Dickerson Jr. buy it for you. Oh, he didn't see that coming. He takes it a whole lot better than his dad does, let me say that. And so you'll want to be in the service tomorrow night as we have the closing service, and the Lord has laid upon my heart to preach on the subject, America in the Shadow of Calvary. You won't want to miss the service tomorrow night. Isaiah chapter 44 and verse number 8. Fear ye not, neither be afraid. Have not I told thee from that time, and have declared it? Ye are even my witnesses. Is there a God beside me? Yea, there is no God. I know not any. Little phrase in this verse that I would call your attention to, and it's the phrase, ye are even my witnesses. Do you see it? There it is. Ye are even my witnesses. And for a few moments, I want to speak to you on the subject tonight, why I witness the way I do. Let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, I want to thank you for this privilege to stand behind a sacred desk to preach the Word of God. If in my heart I want to be a blessing, but the only way that I can be is if you hide me behind the cross and fill me with the Spirit. Place a hedge around this great church by the blood of Christ to keep the devil and his demons from hindering this service. Save the sinner and stir the saint. Heavenly Father, for all that you'll do in our midst and even in our hearts tonight, we will be careful to give you all the praise and honor and glory. Bless and protect my precious family as I'm away. Give us fresh, warm bread from the oven of heaven to feed from tonight. And Lord, I'd request, oh, how I would request that you'd clothe me in my calling. For we ask these things in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. And you may be seated. The triune God expects the child of God to have enthusiasm and excitement for evangelism. Those who have been personal soul winners for long seasons of time have been able to plug into their lives truths that keep them passionate for lost souls. Motivation for the main thing in the Christian life is mandatory. Why I witness the way I do. In the book of Isaiah, chapter 44, we find the promise of the Spirit, which there births and brings the power of the soul winner. This chapter could be effortlessly or easily outlined like this: the faithfulness of God, verses 1 through 8. The folly of idolatry, verses 9 through 20. And then the future of Israel, verses 21 through 28. It is well the prophet Isaiah is dealing under the direct inspiration of the Holy Spirit with the faithfulness of God, that a person there sees God the Father put his divine finger on a particular decree for all of his family members. Verse 8, fear ye not, neither be afraid. Have not I told thee from that time, and have declared it? Ye are even my witnesses. Is there a God beside me? Yea, there is no God. I know not any. The word witnesses, Dr. Lathley, means a separate group of people who see or otherwise have secured personal knowledge of someone or something, and in turn share or even spread that knowledge. The sister verse of Isaiah 44:8 is Acts 1:8. And as I've said many times, and as you've heard me say countless times, every verse in the Bible has what I call a sister verse, and often that sister verse throws more light upon the verse that you're musing, meditating, or making a study of. Again, the sister verse of Isaiah 44:8 is Acts 1:8. But ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost part of the earth. Dr. John R. Rice once penned, all Bible truth is great truth. He went on to write, but Bible truth divorced from soul winning is perverted truth, dead truth. Any doctrine taught which ignores the one central basis of Christian truth, and that Christ came into the world to save sinners, and the basic all command of the Great Commission to go into all the world and win souls, is fruitless doctrine. Dr. Rice wrote, powerless truth. Never forget, it is only those, both in the natural arena and the supernatural arena, who are able to stir themselves that succeed at those things that they've set out to accomplish. If you miss everything that I preach tonight, I pray that you would not miss that, and it even bears repeating. It is only It is only both in the natural arena and the supernatural arena, those who are able to stir themselves that succeed at those things that they set out to accomplish. Friend, you and I, those of us that are saved, ought to have certain truths that challenge us to completely tell others about the Lord Jesus Christ. Now I keep in my satchel, and I travel with it, a piece of paper out of a legal pad, and on that piece of paper are the names Flavor Flav. He's the rapper and hype man, so-called reality television star. There's the name Joe Dumars, who is a former Detroit Piston, an NBA Basketball Hall of Fame member. He has a sportsmanship award that's named after him in the NBA, and at one time the president of operations for the Detroit Pistons. On that piece of paper is the name Jacob Landry. He's a television star from Swamp People. On that piece of paper is the name Sherman Arnold. Sherman Arnold is a famous Elvis impersonator who literally is in the Elvis Presley impersonator Hall of Fame. On that piece of paper is the name Rick Ross, rapper and a songwriter, so-called. On that piece of paper that I carry with me in my satchel all the time is the name Terry Mills, who is a former Detroit Piston. On that piece of paper is the name Darius Johnson Oldham, who is a college basketball star. On that piece of paper is the name Thomas Hitman Hearns, who is a former famous boxer who is in the Boxing Hall of Fame. On that piece of paper is the name Michael T. Lodish, a two-time Super Bowl winner. On that piece of paper is the name John Conyers, who was a liberal congressman in Washington since 1965, who died just not that long ago. On that piece of paper is the name Gregory Kelser, who is a former Spartan and Detroit Piston and now a sports commentator. On that piece of paper is Mike Bonner, a comedian who supposedly has been on HBO. That stands for Hell's Box Office. On that piece of paper is the name Rick Mahorn, a former Detroit Piston. And I carry, Dr. Leithley, that piece of paper with those names on it in my satchel as I travel the country in meetings. You say, who are those people? Well, some are known and some are unknown, but what they all have in common is I've had the privilege of either leading them to Christ or at least giving them a gospel tract. And you and I ought to have things in our lives that absolutely, constantly, and consistently challenge us to be the personal soul winner that God wants us to be. Now, quickly tonight, there are three major truths that motivate me to make witnessing the main thing. Let's quickly notice it tonight. Why I witness the way I do. Number one, the praise in heaven. Revelation 4, 10 and 11. The 24 elders fell down before him that sat on the throne and worshiped him that liveth forever and ever, and cast their crowns before the throne, saying, Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they are and were created. A major truth that motivates me to make witnessing the main thing is the praise in heaven. In Revelation 4, 10 and 11, the Apostle John tells us about the activity and atmosphere of the glory world. As he pulls back the glorious curtain of time and eternity, a person sees praising, clapping, standing, running, and shouting hallelujah is the constant celebration in the forever city of the clouds. Evangelist Oliver B. Green once wrote about this scenario in the scripture. The throne was actually the first vision after John was translated in the spirit from earth to heaven. The throne is the center of the heavenly scene, and it's the symbol of the Lord's universal government. With the chair of the sovereign, center of heaven, shouts of praise, worship, and adoration circle Christ and travel to the furthest corners of the celestial city. If the believer puts their ear to these verses, they hear heaven's choir sing, all hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall, bring forth the royal diadem, and crown him Lord of all. Wait a minute. There's something else that the Word of God mentions, that there starts a shouting storm in the glory world, and that's when a child of the devil becomes a child of God. The unknown poet put it best when he simply penned, in heaven, cherub newsboys shout their extras fast as printed and spread the joyful news about, a sinner has repented. Friend, you and I ought to be motivated to make witnessing the main thing because of the praise in heaven. The Bible says in Luke 15:7, I say unto you that likewise joy shall be in heaven over one sinner that repenteth more than the 99 just persons which need no repentance. It's not the master's green jacket, the World Series championship trophy, the Super Bowl ring, the Larry O'Brien NBA championship trophy, the gold medal from the Olympics, but a burning brand snatched from the fire that puts all heaven on its feet. Oh, the reason I witness the way I do is because of the praise in heaven. Can you imagine the 30 years now that the Bible Baptist Church has been a bright light in a dark world? Can you imagine all the times they've been shouting in heaven when people have trusted Christ through the ministry of this church? I wonder how many times in 30 years, all those flags representing a missionary that this church supports. I wonder in these 3 decades, Dr. Leithley, how many times they've been shouting in heaven because of the prayers, because of the pennies that the Bible Baptist Church has given a missionary that's led someone to Christ. I wonder how many times those gospel tracts have landed in the hand of someone who's turned their heart towards heaven. Man, I want you to know, up in heaven, they're shouting. Up in heaven, they're rejoicing. Up in heaven, they're saying hallelujah, glory to God, amen. The reason I witness the way I do is because of the praise in heaven. This afternoon, I was having my lunch, and I received a phone call from a dear friend of 35 plus years, Dr. Joe Arthur. And Dr. Joe Arthur called this afternoon. He said, Dr. Hamblin, you got a minute? I said, absolutely. He said, just want to share something with you to encourage you. He said, remember that Sunday that you preached for me back in December? I thought to myself, yeah, I remember it. I got the coronavirus after being with you. I remember it. And he did too. And another preacher did as well. We all got it at the Atlanta airport. But he said, remember that Sunday that you were with me? By the way, he told me something very personal, and I want you to pray for him, because he shared with me that he's now identifying himself. Please pray for Dr. Joe Arthur. He said, I'm now identifying myself as trans slender. You thought for a minute you had something to gossip about. But back to the message. I told him I identified right there. But he said, you remember that Sunday that you preached for me back in December? And I'm always there in December right before Christmas. And I said, absolutely. And he said, you remember you preached and you gave an invitation and we had some decisions. In fact, we had an altar full. And after the service was over, you were signing Bibles. And a young man came back in and said, Dr. Hamblin, I was out in the parking lot and I went to get in the car to go home, but I couldn't because I'm lost and I need to get saved. He said, you remember that? I said, how can I forget? He said, I just thought I'd share with you. On Saturday, he was out soul winning. And he said, on Sunday night while I was preaching, he said, all of a sudden, for the first time, he stood on his feet and shouted. And then he said, I just want you to know, Wednesday night would have been last night, Brother Dickerson Jr. He said, and he was in church, and he's been in church, and he's been in church, and he's been in church every time the doors are open. And I want you to know I rejoiced and I said hallelujah and I shouted. But friend, that pales in comparison to all the rejoicing they do in heaven every time somebody gets saved. See, I witness the way I do because of the praise in heaven. At the age of 90, a man by the name of Jesse Mattis proudly wears again his class ring. In 1938, when he was 18 years of age, Jesse had accidentally lost his class ring in the bathroom at work. While on the job, a city worker, Tony Congee, found the ring and recognized the crest as the same high school from which he had graduated. Based on the few clues the ring provided, notably the few initials inside and the graduation year, 1938, initials being JTM, Congee set about to hunt down the owner of the ring. After tracking down, oh my, a 1938 yearbook, he determined the only name to match the initials was Jesse T. Mattis. Congee also found a member of the 1938 graduating class still living in the area. The man was Mattis' best friend and helped Congee in the last steps to reuniting ring with its owner after 72 years apart. The smile that came across Jesse Mattis' face when his class ring was returned doesn't even come close to the smile that comes across the face of our lovely Lord Jesus Christ when news hits heaven that a boy, a girl, a young man, a young woman, an elderly man, an elderly woman leaves darkness and meets the light of the world, the praise in heaven. Now, my dear brother, I think about them 152 churches you started. I know they're 52, but I'm an evangelist and we exaggerate about everything. I think about those 52 churches, sir, that you started in Papua New Guinea. Every time somebody gets saved, every time somebody trusts Christ, every time they get their name written down in the Lamb's Book of Life up in heaven, they're not yawning. Up in heaven, they're not taking a nap. Up in heaven, they're not checking their Facebook status. No, sir. No, ma'am. They're shouting up in heaven the praise in heaven. Number two, I have to hasten. Not only the praise in heaven, number two, the plenty in harvest. John 4:35, say not ye, there yet 4 months, and then cometh harvest, Behold, I say unto you, lift up your eyes and look on the fields, for they are white already to harvest. The major truth that motivates me to make witnessing the main thing is the plenty in harvest. In John 4:35, the Lord Jesus Christ tells us about a ready and reachable gleaning from the fields of this world. Before the lazy and lackadaisical and loose-living believer wants to list a thousand reasons why they can't lead anyone to conversion, maybe they should find out that this scripture is read, which is letting every single person know that the Savior said, that the Savior said, that the Savior said, people can be saved and scores of them. Breaking news, with 7.5 billion, with a B, people in the world, the personal soul winner, oh my, can do something to see a bunch of them born again. Friend, you and I ought to be motivated to make witnessing the main thing because of the plenty in harvest. Now there are several needful things the Christian can do to help bring in the harvest. And it may shock you, stun you, and even surprise you. But first of all, observation. Luke 19:41, and when he was come near, he beheld the city and wept over it. A needful thing the Christian can do to help bring in the harvest is observation. It is not until the soul winner sees the magnitude of the task that they'll set out to match the task. I'm not being harsh, God knows my heart. But I wonder how many times we come to church on a Sunday night or a Wednesday night, or we come to church on a Thursday night of a 30th anniversary revival celebration, and we pass house after house after house that has light after light after light on in that house after house, and it dawns on us that those are souls for whom Jesus died. Observation. Secondly, cooperation. Matthew 9:38, pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest that he will send forth laborers into his harvest. A needful thing the Christian can do to help bring in the harvest is cooperation. It is amazing how the praying knee is on the same spiritual body as the door knocking hand and the telling others about Jesus. I didn't stick my tongue out at you, but tongue. Cooperation. Thirdly, saturation. Acts 5:28, ye have filled Jerusalem with your doctrine and intend to bring this man's blood upon us. A needful thing that the Christian can do to help bring in the harvest is saturation. If the local pizza parlor has more flyers in the neighborhood than you have gospel tracts out, shame on you. Don't bow your head. We're nowhere near closing in prayer time. Saturation. Oh, that every Christian that is in this service would realize the needful things that they can do to help bring in the harvest is observation, cooperation, and saturation. One time, Fanny Crosby, the blind hymn writer, visited the McAuree Mission in New York. She asked if there was a boy there who had no mother and if he would come up and let her put her hand on his head. A motherless fellow came up and she put her arms about him and kissed him. She went from that meeting back to her hotel room and wrote, rescue the perishing, care for the dying, snatch them in pity from sin in the grave, weep o'er the erring one, lift up the fallen, tell them of Jesus, the mighty to save. Sometime later, Dr. Leithley when Ira Sankey was about to sing a song in St. Louis, he related that incident. A man sprang to his feet in the audience and said, "I'm the boy she kissed that night. I was never able to get away from the impression made by that touching act. I've become a Christian." Isn't it wonderful that a believer who was blind still had spiritual sight to see someone in soul's need and did a significant part to see them saved? Oh, why do you witness the way you do? I've witnessed the way I do because of the plenty in harvest. Bible Baptist Church, thank God for your soul winning all these years. But there's still lost people in Cambridge. And there's still lost people in Bysville. And there's still lost people in this county. And thank God for 3 decades of being a bright light in a dark world. But the job's not done. The task isn't finished. We still need to reach lost souls. The plenty in harvest. And then number 3, and last of all, not only the praise in heaven. Boy, it just thrills me. Little boy gets on a bus, comes to church, Bible Baptist Church in Byesville, Ohio, and some bus worker tells the sweet story of Jesus and his love, and that little bus child trusts Christ as their Savior. And you may never see him again, but you'll see him in eternity. And the moment that that little boy, the moment that little girl, the moment that teenage boy, that teenage girl, the moment that that young adult trusted Christ, I want you to know up in heaven, they're shouting. Up in heaven, they're rejoicing. You know, heaven didn't even, it didn't even move the excitement meter when the illegitimate individual in the White House signed whatever he did this week. Say amen right there. That didn't move the meter. But when people get saved, man, they rejoice and they shout and they praise the Lord. Why you witness the way you do? I witness the way I do because of the praise in heaven. I witness the way I do because of the plenty in harvest. You see, I'm not being a hog. When I win someone to Christ, I've got good news. You can win one too. When I win 5 to Christ, I'm not being selfish. You can win 5 too. When I get somebody to Calvary, I'm not being piggish, but you can get someone to Calvary too. But plenty and harvest. And then number 3 and last of all, not only the praise in heaven, and the plenty and harvest, but number 3 and last of all, the prayer in hell. Luke 16, 27 and 28, then he said, "I pray thee therefore, Father, that thou wouldest send into my father's house, for I have 5 brethren, that he may testify unto them, lest they also come into this place of torment." A major truth that motivates me to make witnessing, the main thing, is the prayer in hell. In Luke 16, 27 and 28, the physician Luke tells us about the pleas and the pain of the underworld, the last place a person would think that there would be a prayer meeting is in the charred caverns of the damned, but there is, and they're praying for Christians and churches to get on fire for lost souls. H.A. Ironside, the great Bible student, once said about this scene in the Scriptures, look at this. You have a praying man in hell, but the trouble was he began praying on the wrong side of the tomb. He went through life prayerless. The moment he got over on the other side, he began to pray. You know what the number one prayer request in the bottomless pit is? Be interesting, Dr. Leithley, to do a survey, do a study. Maybe 6 months of Wednesday nights to find out what the number one prayer request is. The number one prayer request in hell, it may shock you, stun you, it may even surprise you, but that number one prayer request in the bottomless pit is that he may testify unto them, lest they also come in to this place of torment. Friend, you and I ought to be motivated to make witnessing the main thing because of the prayer in hell. The Bible says in Matthew 22:13, then said the king to the servants, bind him hand and foot and take him away and cast him into utter darkness. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. If the believer, and time out, I probably should have told you the background, the backdrop of this sermon. 1 week I was in two different conferences. First part of the week I preached in one conference. Second part of the week I preached in another conference. And I probably should have given you the background, backdrop in the background of the message earlier. But I got in my plane seat and I thought about the preaching that I'd heard and the preaching that I did in that first conference. And Brother Matthews, as I was making my way to the next conference, two in 1 week, I thought about the preaching that I was going to do and the preaching I'd probably hear. And when I was sitting in that plane seat, I know this never happens to you. You're a visitor from heaven. But us real people who live in the real world and are very transparent will tell you about things that happen in our life that it's just no put on. It's just real. And as I sat in that plane seat, and I know this never happens to you, but I got a bad attitude. I know it never happens to you. You're a visitor from heaven. That never happens to you. I got a bad attitude, Dr. Lethley, because I thought about the preaching I heard and the preaching I did and the preaching I was going to do and going to hear probably in the second half of the week in another conference, and I got a bad attitude because I sat there and I thought to myself, you know what? It's been a long time. It's been a long time since I heard a sermon on soul winning from start to stop. I'm not talking about a cameo appearance. Now, since we're not in the nursery, no sense putting baby powder on the Bible. Hello? Can I go ahead and preach? I thought to myself, been a long time since I've heard a full-blown soul-winning sermon. It used to be when you went to a conference, you just knew somebody was going to preach on personal soul-winning and somebody was going to preach on prayer and somebody was going to preach on the power of God. And now it seems like those are the missing notes in a lot of meetings. I sat in that plane seat, and I mean, I was working on a real good, bad attitude. And I sat there and I said, Lord, it's a crying shame. It's a crying shame. I can't even remember the last time I've heard a full-blown sermon on soul winning, and the Lord agreed with me. And he said in my heart, you're right, and it's been longer since I heard you preach one. I said, yes, Lord, Brother Dickerson, Jr. And I pulled out my Bible and a legal pad and outline this thought. I actually remember, Brother Matthews, you got Noah's signature in your Bible. You remember that? Did he smile? I can't tell. It's too far back there. Brother Matthews, you remember? You remember when preachers preached on soul winning? Whole sermons. Not cameo appearances, whole sermons. You know why people don't go soul winning anymore? They're not motivated to. They're not moved to. They're not made to. And friend, listen, the reason I witness the way I do is because of the praise in heaven. The reason I witness the way I do is because of the plenty and harvest. But wait a minute, hold it. Stop the press. The reason I witness the way I do is because of the prayer in hell. If the believer in the Bible-believing church ever hears the supplication wrapped in the screams of those already in a crisis eternity, we would see the largest surge, Dr. Lethley, of souls saved in the entire history of the cause of Christ. Prayer in hell. I'm closing with this. Several years ago, I was holding a revival meeting in Fort Worth, Texas. One day, the preacher that I was with, Dr. R.A. Smith, took me to the Greenwood Cemetery, where J. Frank Norris, Louis Ensminger, and Lee Scarborough are all buried. Now, I've got to tell you a little hobby I have. And I probably, through these years that I've been preaching here, I'm sure I've shared it. But I've got a hobby of visiting the graves of great Christians, great preachers, great servants of God. And there's something about visiting their grave that you'll have a forever connect in that you can never read them, you can never quote them, you can never hear about them. But what you remember, you know what, I visited their grave. And there's another reason, really, that I try to visit as many graves as I can. If the Lord stays his coming and I go the way of all flesh, it'd be kind of nice if somebody visited mine. Now, please don't eat your sandwich on the headstone, but it'd be kind of nice if the Lord should stay his coming that somebody might want to stop by and see mine. No, I won't be there, but just stop and see mine. And so Dr. R.A. Smith knows that it's kind of a hobby of mine. And took me to Greenwood Cemetery, where all those great servants of God are buried. J. Frank Norris, Louis Ensminger, and Lee Scarborough. When he took me to Lee Scarborough's grave, which was the last, he is a famous evangelist of the 1900s and the author of the classic book, With Christ After the Lost. In fact, it's interesting, Dr. Lethley, because he was Dr. John R. Rice's personal evangelism instructor in college. So we could say that Dr. John R. Rice, the great personal soul winner, learned to be a great personal soul winner at the feet of Dr. Lee Scarborough. An argument could be made for that. Well, when we visited that last grave, went to Norris, went to Ensminger, went to Scarborough. That was the last grave that we visited. I took Brother Atkinson, I took about one step from Lee Scarborough's grave, and I happened to look down, and I saw a very odd, a very unusual, a very, just strange headstone, and it was the headstone of Margaret Robin Peale. She was born on September 12th, 1958, and she died February 15th, 2006. And on her headstone was, if you will, a supplication of sorts, as it said, Oh God, that it were possible to undo things done, to call back yesterday, that time could turn up its swift sandy glass to untell the days and redeem these hours. I would later learn that it was Thomas Heywood, a prominent English playwright and author and actor of the late Elizabethan era, who had said that. Listen to it again. I mean, just a step, if that, from Lee Scarborough's grave. Oh God, that it were possible to undo things done, to call back yesterday, that time could turn up its swift sandy glass to untell the days and redeem these hours. As I stood there, staring at that headstone, I couldn't help but think, that's a prayer that can never be answered. That's a prayer that can be prayed every day for 10 million years. And Brother Matthews, it'll never, ever be answered. And then I thought about how those in hell are praying that I might win their loved ones to Christ. And that's a prayer that I can have a part in answering. Someone in hell right now is praying for you to win their family to Christ. Someone in hell right now is praying that you and I would get off the stick of do nothing and quit whittling at the stick of do less and win their family to Christ. 30 years is commendable. I don't know if I mentioned it yet or not. Congratulations. 30 years is worthy of a celebration. But at the same time, people are dying and going to hell from Cambridge. People are dying and going to hell from Byesville. People are dying and going to hell from this county. We can be an answer to the prayers of those who are in hell by reaching their family. Our text says in Isaiah 44 and 10, "Ye are even my witnesses." Why I witness the way I do. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. We have seen from the pages of the Bible tonight, really, just a very simple thought. Just a simple truth on what motivates me personally to be a personal soul winner. The praise in heaven, the plenty in harvest, the prayer in hell. We stand to our feet with every head bowed and every eye closed. I wonder who would lift their hand and say, "Preacher, I know that I know that I know that I know. If I were to die right now, heaven is my eternal home. I'm saved and sure." You'd lift your hand and leave it saved and sure. Saved and sure. Saved and sure. Thank you. May I put them down. You're here tonight, dear one, and you couldn't raise your hand. Are we still on, my brother, in the sound booth? Are we still on the internet? You're watching by way of live stream, YouTube. Possibly 50 years from now, you're watching. You need Jesus. You know you're but a heartbeat from hell. You know you're but a breath from the bottomless pit. And you need to receive Christ right now before it's eternally too late. You say, "Preacher, I would, but I don't know how." Realize you're a sinner. Recognize that Jesus laid his life down on the cross, shed his blood, rose again from the dead, that you might be saved in a simple childlike faith. Say, "Jesus, come into my heart and save me." It's that simple. And then I want you to put in that feed where those comments are. I want you to just put in that feed, "I trusted Christ," and put the day. And man, when we see it, we'll shout, rejoice, and we'll reach out and try to help you any way we can. But you may be in this service, in this building, and you know you're not saved. You know you're not saved. And all that tonight, you'd receive Christ as your Savior. Christian, what about it? When's the last time that you made an effort to get somebody to Jesus? You'd lift your hand and say, "Tonight, preacher, tonight, God has spoken to my heart." God bless you there and there and all over, all over, all over, all over, all over, all over, all over. God bless you. Thank you. May I put them down? Now listen, I'm not being harsh. I'm not. Please. Shouldn't even have to say that as long as I've been preaching here. But we need to put feet to that acknowledgement, to that raised hand. And the best place to start going after sinners, hear me now, the best place, the best starting block is off an old-fashioned altar. So many times we hear Dr. Lethley, a message like this, and we say, "All right, I'm going to try to win somebody to Jesus," and we have the wrong starting block. We start from our pew instead of starting from an altar on our knees, asking God to help and to work not only on their end, but to work on our end as well. Heavenly Father, thank you for the kind attention of these, my brothers and sisters. And Lord, I pray that not one in any way would grieve, resist, or quench the Holy Spirit. May this be a time of great and glorious victory. In Jesus' name. Our heads are bowed. These altars are open. Would you come? No piano, no singing, no music. Just really, Dr. Lethley, an unvarnished invitation. That's what it is. An unvarnished invitation. Would you come? Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Would you come? Why I witness the way I do. It might be your coming, heads bowed, eyes closed, would cause someone else to come. It might be your decision would spark a decision with someone else. You know, there are things, Dr. Lethley, you know it, that a believer can go to seed on. And I've seen it. I've seen believers go to seed on things. But hear me, soul winning is not one of them. In fact, I'd like to meet a believer that tried to go to seed on soul winning, that tried to go too far with soul winning. You can't do it. Why I witness the way I do. Pastor comes and takes charge of the service.
Thank you, Dr. Hamblin. I needed that message. And I know you did too by the upraised hands. You always need to be challenged to remember that the message of the gospel does not stop with us. It starts with us. I know we don't have an instrument here, but I want us to sing a song tonight. Get your songbooks if you would. Turn to page number 401. Page number 401. Dr. Cummins used to sing this song all the time when he would preach messages like this, challenging us as students and the church to be more active in being a witness. We're going to sing this song, page number 401. Set my soul afire, Lord, for thy holy word. Burn it deep within me. Let your voice be heard. Millions grope in darkness in this day and hour. I will be your witness. Fill me with thy power. Set my soul afire, Lord, set my soul afire. Make my life a witness of thy saving power. Millions grope in darkness, waiting. Let's sing all of the song, verse 2. Set my soul afire, Lord, for the lost in sin. Give to me a passion as I seek to win.
your spirit, let thy will prevail. Set my soul afire, Lord. Set my soul afire. Make my life a witness of thy saving power. Hear me enthroned in darkness, waiting for thy word. Set my soul afire, Lord. Set my soul afire.
And the last verse, verse 3. Set my soul afire, Lord, in my daily life. Far too long I've wandered in this day of strife. Nothing else will matter but to live for thee. I will be your witness as you live in me. Set my soul afire, Lord. Set my soul afire. Make my life a witness of thy saving power. Millions grope in darkness, waiting for thy word. Set my soul afire, Lord. Set my soul afire.
All right, be seated if you would for just a moment. Dr. Hamblin's going to come back up.
Well, I hope that you go by the book table. You pretty much know what's on the table. Seven reasons I can't become a compromising liberal, the religion of the new cart, and there is neology. Is there anyone in the meeting, and I know that there have been several that folks have gotten, is there anyone who has gotten neology and has already started to use it? Is there anybody like that? Would you recommend it? Has it been a help to you? What have you liked about it? Amen. Amen. There's a good recommendation right there. My brother, what would you started to use it? What would you say about it? And don't say ditto. I mean, you
say about the same thing.
Sure. Amen. Praise the Lord. Thank you, fellas. I didn't say this before they said that, because I just wanted to hear what they said. But when writing it, my goal was for the statements. Every day I make a statement about prayer. And my goal was, fellas, for that to jumpstart our prayer life, to use it as a jumpstart to our prayer life. And so they just gave a good recommendation, good endorsement on it, and I hope that you'll go by and get it. I still have some on the table, and the Lord has just used it in a great way. I was in a meeting 2 weeks ago, and a lady came to me, and she said, I got the book from you. She said, I got it from your website, and she said, I've used it so much that she said, I've got electrical tape. She said, I broke the binding out. And she said, my copy's got electrical tape. So I sold her 5 more copies. So I hope, not really, 6. So I hope that you'll go by and you'll take advantage of that which is on the book table tomorrow night. It's the last night of the meeting. And I want us to do our best to be back and to bring someone with us. How many will try to be back tomorrow night and bring someone with them? They'll try to be back and bring someone with you. Okay, let's do our best to do that. And let's get the word out. I'll be preaching tomorrow night, the Lord being my helper, the message, America in the Shadow of Calvary. You won't want to miss the close to a great meeting tomorrow night. Thank you, Pastor.
All right, let's stand together and be dismissed in prayer this evening. Be in prayer tomorrow for the last service tomorrow night. We'll be looking forward to hearing the message. Pastor Gary Matthews, would you dismiss us in prayer, please?